Hi there, Lindsay here, the Frugal Crafter. This is a speed paint of the painting I did on Friday's live stream, but unfortunately I had some technical issues, so while the real-time video is still available, I will link to it in the video description, I have just voiced over the speed paint because there were a few audio and video issues that were not on my end, surprisingly. So I thought I would put this up there just for anybody who missed it or just doesn't want to deal with intermittent technical issues during the broadcast. I can understand why you wouldn't want to deal with that. So what we're going to do here is begin by sketching with watercolor pencils on watercolor paper, and I am using Derwent Inktense pencils, and I've got this nice bright yellow, and I'm sketching the body of the bird here, and then I've switched to a blue pencil and I'm sketching the head, beak, tail, and just kind of shoulders actually. And I'm just putting in indications for the feet. Now I apologize when the video goes a little fuzzy. It's because there were some server issues on the video and there was nothing I could really do about it. But hopefully this will give you a watchable experience. I'm using some brown just to sketch in a branch. And I just basically want to kind of map out my painting at this point. By the way, if you are looking to enroll in a watercolor course, my Essential Tools and Technique for Watercolor class is on sale through Monday the 17th. I just wanted to put that in there too, because I know some of you guys missed the intro special and they wanted to grab it. And just using the pink pencil here, I'm just kind of sketching in a few of the buds and then a few leaves with the green. Now the benefit of using the Inktense pencils versus another watercolor pencil, and you can totally use whatever watercolor pencils you have, is that once you add water to the color from the Inktense, it actually will make it permanent, kind of like ink. So if I add water to all these portions, let them dry, I can paint over them without them bleeding or smearing or anything. So it's kind of a nice feature that those particular pencils have. I will link in the video description all of the color names or color numbers that I used in case you're trying to match exactly. But again, as I said, use whatever you have and just kind of go with whatever you have color-wise that's closest. So I wanted to have kind of a rough border on my picture, so I'm just kind of wetting the edges and just kind of splashing on water here and there because I want to have a very loose fluid look to this painting. So on top of the painting, I'm just flicking on some phthalo blue and just letting it run around, and I can tip my paper and help it move. I've also flicked in some olive green, and same idea, just letting the colors kind of move and groove around, and it's just going to allow me to create a very loose, random looking background that I think is nice occasionally to do. Now by flicking on the quinacridone rose, it's going to give the illusion of like buds in a tree and branches further away. And then I'm just kind of guiding some of the paint here and there. Like if I see too much color here and I don't have anything over there, I'll just kind of move it. You just kind of want to go by your own aesthetics when you're doing this. There's no right or wrong way. Just have fun with it and enjoy the process. I think that's the best advice that I can give anyone who is painting. You're going to want to let this background dry before you do anything on top. Here is the finished painting, just so you can kind of see how the layers are going to go. And I used my heat tool to help dry it, but you could always just step away for a couple hours and let it completely dry. Whichever is better for you, go ahead and do that. I like to build up a variety of different textures, and I like some soft and blendy colors and also some hard colors that are a little more vibrant. So, you know, having that contrast is kind of nice. Just keep repeating the same colors you've been using. So now I'm using some Hansa Yellow Light on the top of the bird's chest, and then I'm adding some gamboge underneath. And I'm just kind of using little choppy strokes that kind of go with the direction of the body. I want to make sure I follow the contours so they'll look kind of feathery. And you can kind of urge the colors to kind of work into each other a little bit. I'm adding a little bit of burnt umber so that I can darken up some of the feathers where it'll be a little bit more shadowy. And again, keeping with that short linear stroke, just going in the direction of the contour of the body, just to give it that feathery look. I can also drag out little bitty feathers like on the edge, like I did right there under the wing, and it just helps the bird look fluffy as opposed to like a solid object. If I just painted it straight on the edge, it would just look a little bit more solid and less fluffy. So give that a try. If you work on the tip top of your brush, you should be able to get a nice fine line, but if you need, you can go in with a smaller brush. And then for in the center of the belly, I want a little bit of a shadow. So I just took some burnt umber and added a little phthalo blue, because that's the blue I have been using together, and just put a wash of that in the tummy. And then we'll be adding more later, but I just wanted to get that kind of down right now. So I had something underneath the darker feathers that are going to go there later. And I'm using a little phthalo blue to paint the tail here, and then adding a little of that burnt umber blue mix in the shadow area, because it's not really, it's only like really bright at the edges where you're seeing the kind of outside feathers. And now I am using some phthalo blue up at the top of the head, fairly concentrated, so it's nice and dark. And I'm going to go around the back of the head and around the eye. Now, around the eye is actually going to end up being almost black when we're done, but I like to get that base color down first so it kind of blends in and looks natural. We're not going to use black paint, though. We're going to make our mix of phthalo blue and burnt umber when we get to that point. I'm just kind of blocking in colors at this point. When you're putting your color in, especially around that white area, you want to kind of flick the blue into the white area because you're kind of painting around those white feathers. So just kind of keep that in mind. No straight solid blocks. We want to, anytime we can save a little time by putting in a little bit of a feather flick or a kind of little line instead of just a straight. Does this make any sense? I want to have a little bit of that feathery texture, so I just don't want like straight blocky areas on the bird. I guess that's what I'm going for. I want to get that little bit of fluff there. So it's basically a matter of just kind of lining up colors. Now for the eye, I want an almost black color, so I'm using the burnt umber and phthalo blue, and fairly thickly. I realized that brush I had was a little too juicy and it was going to hold way too much water, so I switched over to a synthetic Royal and Langnickel Fusion brush. Any sort of little spotter is going to be just fine for that, and I decided to go with that because I can flick on tiny little feathers as opposed to worrying about like maybe having a bead of water or too much paint and water come off of my brush. So I'm just using that to kind of just flick in little details, those little detail feathers around the eye, and it really starts to make the bird's face come alive. And now I'm going in on the beak with that same brush and that same mix. So the downside to using a brush as small is that you have to reload much more frequently because there's not that many bristles and the belly of the brush is not that big, so it just can't hold that much water and paint. So you do have to reload more often, but the trade-off is that you get a nice, fine, sharp little detail, and you honestly can't get yourself into too much trouble puttering around with a little brush like this. So I figured while I was at it and I had that color all mixed up, I would do some of the detailing on the tummy. There's some dark feathers on the belly, and I thought that would be a great way to get them in there and then not have to worry about getting too much color down. And then I added water to that mix, and I just went in and added some of the some toning to the face because it's not perfectly white. And then I'm using my credit card scraper just to scratch in some little feathers. And I really like the way that turned out. I don't like to fuss on one part of the painting too long, especially the focal point like the bird. So I decided I would go ahead and work on the branch. So I'm using burnt umber and my big juicy number 12 round. And I'm going in and getting those branches in. And basically what I'm doing here is painting over what I had sketched in with the brown Inktense pencil. And then I'm going in with yellow ochre and just kind of painting right along next to that and letting the colors smoosh together. And then with Quin Rose, I am just taking that same brush and just dabbing in some little flower buds. Try to keep it loose, try to keep it fun. You don't want everything in sharp focus. The bird's in sharp focus. Everything else is supporting the star. Everything else is making the bird look good. So everything except for the focal point is there to enhance our focal point. And I'm going in with some olive green. Feel free to use sap green if that's what you have, and painting in some very loose leaves. So the key here is to have some foreground objects. That's what these are. These are the things in focus, the bird, the branch, and those crisp flowers. We have the way background stuff. That is the smushy stuff from the first layer. And then we have these flecks and these splotches that we're doing now. And this is more of the middle ground layer. And this is where, it kind of goes between the sharp focus and the muddled focus and gives us that sense of fullness that the painting should have when we're done. Now, the palette that I'm using here is the Portable Painter, and it is a travel palette. I will link to it in the video description in case you're curious. It does not come with paint. You have to put your own paint in there, and I have just a random collection of different colors, and I do have that listed in the video description as well if you are curious. So also to add to that mid-ground, not super smooshy, not focusy, I'm dabbing in some color with my big round brush because we need that kind of in-between area that's not super soft and not super sharp. I really am liking that palette, the Portable Painter, because it's got two water buckets, one on each side. It's definitely, I generally would use a bigger water bucket and a bigger palette if I'm doing a painting this large, but it worked out fine. So before you go in and add any more detail anywhere, you want to dry this layer. Otherwise, if you say you're painting the bird's leg and it touches a wet puddle, it's just going to whoosh. It's just going to wick out. And you might not like that effect. It might be a nice effect. You might like it. It might not. You'll see in a minute how that happens near the bird's head. And I actually like the effect. If it happens and you don't like it, you can always blot it off. So now I'm going in with my small round brush. This is a number 2 Mimic. And I am just putting in the legs from my little bird here. And then I'm just kind of flicking in some little lines for the feathers at the top of the leg, kind of where it meets the body and it has those little bit of little teeny tiny little feathers. And then I'm going to jump around to the little leaves and go back in with some olive green and just paint kind of some shadows and just kind of crisp up and define some of the edges. So it's a lot of just jumping around. This painting is about 11 by 15, so it's not tiny. There's definitely places to work while other parts are drying. Doing the same thing with the red here, with the quinacridone rose, going in and adding kind of some crisper details and just basically putting in marks and splashes of color where I think it's necessary. So now I've got some yellow ochre, a little bit of burnt umber in there, and I'm going in and adding some more shadow on the chest of the bird, also on the tail to kind of tone down some of the blue, basically tempering my colors. Now I'd say that it needs to be a little bit darker in some areas, so I'm going in with the straight phthalo blue and just intensifying some of the color there. And you can see how that blue wicked out into a puddle in the background. I actually like that. I think it's kind of pretty, so I left it, but I could just press a paper towel down, press it, don't rub, and you can lift most of that right off if you get right to it when it happens. Phthalo blue is a staining color, so I figured I'm just going to leave it because I think it looks better to have some there intentionally than to try to remove it and have a little bit of a ghost. I just liked it better this way, but that's completely up to you. And then with the burnt umber, I can go in and I can sharpen up the legs. I can add more detail to the feather on the chest. I can add shadows on the tail. Just basically go anywhere I want to make the color a little darker and more earthy. And I'm going to give it another dry before I go in to put my final details on. Now, honestly, looking at this today, I would have splashed on some more bigger splots of color, but I didn't do that at this point. I might go back in and do it later, actually. But I decided this is as far as I wanted to paint, so I went in with my white gel pen and just decided to flick out some little white feathers all around the face and just kind of give little highlights to the feet and the legs and just any place I felt like I needed a little sparkle, I decided to go in and do that with the white gel pen. The gel pen I prefer is the Uniball Signo Gel Impact gel pen. I like it because it is super white and opaque and doesn't tend to clog, and it seems to last a lot longer than other brands, so I'll link that up in the video description too if you're interested. Thank you so much for watching. The real-time version will be linked in the video description. Please bear with any audio difficulties, and if you're interested in my watercolor course, it's on sale till Monday. Thank you so much for watching. Until next time, happy crafting!